A Disposition to be Rich. How a small-town pastor's son ruined an American president, brought on a Wall Street crash, and made himself the best-hated man in the United States. By Geoffrey C. Ward. Narrated by Robertson Dean. Copyright 2012 by Geoffrey C. Ward. This unabridged audiobook is published by arrangement with Geoffrey C. Ward, care of Brant and Hockman Literary Agents, and was produced in the year 2012 by Tantor Media Incorporated, which holds the copyright thereto. Family is what counts. Everything else is a sideshow. F. Champion Ward. If you cannot get rid of the family skeleton, you may as well make it dance. George Bernard Shaw. Prologue. On the afternoon of August 8, 1885, the streets of Manhattan were given over to grief. Ulysses S. Grant had died 5 days earlier, after an agonizing 14-month struggle, first against financial ruin and then against throat cancer, whose every hideous detail had been reported in the newspapers. Nearly a quarter of a million people had shuffled past the ex-president's bier at City Hall. Now, his coffin was to be borne north along Broadway to a specially prepared vault in Riverside Park at 122nd Street. No event, not even the funeral procession of Abraham Lincoln along the same street a little more than 20 years earlier, had drawn such crowds to the city. The 2-year-old Brooklyn Bridge was closed to vehicles that morning so that Brooklynites could pour across the East River to join their fellow mourners in Manhattan. Passengers occupied each seat and stood in every aisle aboard the trains arriving at Grand Central and Pennsylvania stations. So many extra cars had been added to accommodate them that most trains had to be hauled by 2 locomotives. Ferries from New Jersey and Staten Island were packed too, and the new elevated railway brought in some 600,000 more people from the city's outer regions. One onlooker wrote that the entire length of Broadway, shops, offices, hotels, theaters, apartment buildings, was one sweep of black, and even the tenement dwellers crowded along the side streets hung their windows with tiny flags and strips of inky ribbon. The vast black and silver hearse was drawn by 24 black-draped horses, each accompanied by a black groom dressed in black, and it was followed by a glittering military escort under the command of General Winfield Scott Hancock. 60,000 armed men took part in the slow-moving procession, which took 5 hours to pass. Broadway moved like a river into which many tributaries poured, a spectator remembered. There was one living mass choking the thoroughfare from where the dead lay in state to the grim gates at Riverside opened to receive him. Somewhere in that living mass stood a slender, alarmingly pale man wearing smoked glasses so that no one would recognize him. The disguise was probably a good idea. Until his arrest the previous spring, Ferdinand Ward had been Grant's business partner and apparently so skilled that older financiers had hailed him as the young Napoleon of Finance. But now many held him directly responsible for the late general's impoverishment, and even, indirectly, for his death. As Ward himself later wrote, with the strange blend of pride and self-pity he always displayed when alluding to his crimes, he had made himself, by the age of 33, the best-hated man in the United States. He had no right to be on the street that day, in fact. He had bribed his way out of the Ludlow Street jail, where he was awaiting the trial for grand larceny that would soon send him to Sing Sing. In this, as in nearly everything else in his long life, he seems simply to have assumed that rules made for others need never apply to him. Ferdinand Ward was my great-grandfather. I can't remember when I first began to hear stories about him, nor can I remember who first mentioned him to me. It may have been my late father, who had met his grandfather just once while still a small child, and who remembered him only dimly as an apparently amiable, impossibly thin old man with a drooping white mustache rocking on the front porch of a frame house on Staten Island. To a landlocked Ohio boy like my father, the ferry ride across New York Harbor from the Battery had been more memorable than the aged stranger. Perhaps it was my grandfather, Clarence Ward, who first spoke of his father to me. Though he was brought up by maternal relatives and had spent little time in Ferdinand's company, Clarence's bright blue eyes, even in his 80s, still mirrored fear and pain at the mention of his father's name. Little wonder. Ferdinand had hired a man to kidnap my grandfather when he was just 10 years old, flooded him with blackmailing letters as a young man, threatened to see to it that he lost his first job, and finally took him to court, all to get his hands on the small legacy left to his son by his own late wife. In any case, by the time I was 12 or 13, I knew at least the outlines of Ferdinand's story. Pious parents, a Presbyterian minister and his wife, both former missionaries to India, an apparently tranquil boyhood in the lovely village of Geneseo, New York. A move to New York at 21, followed by marriage to a wealthy young woman from Brooklyn Heights, and a swift rise on Wall Street that culminated in the 1880 formation of the firm of Grant and Ward, to include both the former President of the United States and James D. Fish, the president of a large Wall Street financial institution, the Marine National Bank. 4 years of flush times followed. Summer homes, blooded horses, purebred dogs, jewels from Tiffany, European artworks, lavish generosity to family and friends, the birth of a son. Then, disaster. The collapse of first the Marine Bank, then the firm of Grant and Ward, and panic on Wall Street, all of it blamed on Ferdinand Ward. There was Ward's arrest, and that of James Fish, and later two sensational trials that demonstrated that both men had deliberately set out to defraud investors, followed by 7 years in prison, during which Ferdinand's wife and both his parents died. Released in 1892, he devoted most of the 33 years left to him to harassing the son he barely knew, while continuing to hatch schemes by which one person or another was to provide him with money on which to live, funds to which he always seems to have assumed he was somehow entitled. He never changed, never apologized, never explained. I wanted to know more. Books didn't add much. They all focused, understandably enough, on Grant's tragedy. Ferdinand Ward appeared only as a stock villain, insinuating himself on stage just long enough to ruin the ex-president and his family, then disappearing behind prison walls. But I couldn't help wondering how he had duped so many men who, as he himself liked to say, were old enough to be his father. What accounted for what his mother once called his fatal disposition to be rich? How could he have been perpetually unrepentant, uninterested in anyone's troubles but his own, persuaded always that he, and not any of those whose money he misappropriated, was the aggrieved party? My grandfather didn't much like to talk about his father, but I kept after him with a persistence that embarrasses me a little now. One day when I was visiting from college nearly 50 years ago, he turned over to me a dusty cardboard carton filled with brittle papers tied into bundles with dirty twine. They were the contents of Ferdinand Ward's prison trunk, and had rested unread in the closet safe of my grandfather's study in Oberlin, Ohio, for more than half a century. Scores of letters, still in their envelopes. Faded photographs, court documents bound with red ribbon, tiny scraps of paper covered on both sides with near microscopic writing. They offered me the first real clues to what my great-grandfather was like, but they also raised as many questions as they answered, and brought me no closer to grasping what made him the man he came to be. He may have been a sociopath, born without a conscience or the ability to empathize, able only to imitate emotions genuinely felt by other people. He unquestionably was a narcissist. Nothing ever seems to have mattered to him except himself. But the distinctive blend of self-righteousness and deceit, aggression and victimhood he displayed throughout his life, turned out eerily to mirror the distorted personalities of the missionary parents who raised him. Trying to understand those intimate connections and to assess the impact of his depredations on those closest to him, his parents, his bewildered older brother and sister, his wife and his only child, eventually led me to write the story of a family, as well as the biography of a scoundrel. That story begins halfway around the world, with half-hidden events that began to unfold 14 years before Ferdinand Ward was born. Part 1. The Puritan. 1. The Higher Calling. Shortly after dawn on March 20, 1837, at the end of a four-month voyage from Boston, the captain of the American merchant ship Saracen sighted the green Coromandel coast of South India and set his course northward along it, headed for the British port city of Madras, modern Chennai. The Saracen was carrying three distinctive products from New England. Two were in great demand, bales of the rugged cotton twill then called jeans, and more than 100 tons of ice, cut from Massachusetts ponds into big blue-green blocks, then carefully packed into the Saracen's hold, surrounded by layers of lumber, hay, sawdust, and tan bark to minimize melting over the course of the long voyage. For the British, suffering in the Indian heat, the regular arrival of American ice was a godsend. The stoppage of the Bank of Bengal here could hardly exceed the excitement of a failure, during our hot weather, of the ice, one Briton wrote. And the arrival of our English mail is not more anxiously expected than that of an American ice ship when supplies run low. Author's note. The frozen water trade made the Boston entrepreneur Frederick Tudor America's first post-revolutionary millionaire. Thanks to him and his rivals, New England ice tinkled in glasses from Calcutta to the Caribbean, Sydney to South America. The Saracen was under charter by Tudor's first partner, Samuel Austin. The third New England export aboard the Saracen, Puritanism, would find a less cordial welcome. The ship's sole passengers were six American missionaries and their wives, as well as a physician and his wife dedicated to their care. They stood silently together on the quarterdeck, gazing at the distant shoreline. They had left friends and families and endured 118 days at sea in order to help bring their brand of Protestantism to the unconverted millions of the subcontinent, to create what one veteran missionary called New England in India. Timothy Dwight, the president of Yale and a founder of the American Board of Commissioners for Foreign Missions, under whose auspices they had embarked, had set their ambitious agenda. It was their charge, he wrote, to hasten the time when the Romish cathedral, the mosque, and the pagoda shall not have one stone left upon another, which shall not be thrown down. Author's note. Though they saw themselves as pioneers, Americans were actually latecomers to preaching Christianity in South India. Some Indian Christians hold that St. Thomas himself lived and worked there in the first century. The Portuguese converted thousands of Tamil-speaking people to Roman Catholicism in Ceylon and South India during the 16th and 17th centuries. Danish Lutherans established a mission at Trankebar in 1705. The London-based Anglican Society for the Propagation of Christian Knowledge, later the Society for the Propagation of the Gospel, had been on the ground for more than 100 years when the Saracen Company arrived, and missionaries from the non-denominational London Missionary Society had been at work in India since 1794. Still, the newcomers considered themselves the first bringers of the true Christian message. For the little group on deck, prospects of hastening that time did not look immediately reassuring. Every landmark they saw that day underscored the enormity of the task they faced. A beachfront cluster of carved Hindu structures at Mahabalipuram had withstood the pounding surf for more than 1,000 years. The gleaming white Cathedral of St. Thomas, built by the Portuguese and said to mark the original tomb of the Apostle, symbolized for the Americans not Christianity, but popery, more sinister even than the native heathen faith they had been sent to supplant. And when they at last came within sight of Fort St. George, the big coastal bastion from which Britons governed the vast Madras Presidency, the carved gopurams of more Hindu temples and the scattered domes of Muslim mosques appeared above Blacktown, the jumble of mud huts and whitewashed houses that had grown up in the shadow of its walls. The missionaries' worst fears had been confirmed. The city was clearly the home of errorists of every name and grade. Walls of foaming surf made it impossible for large vessels to get anywhere near the shore at Madras. So the captain of the Saracen lowered her sails 2 miles offshore and waited for orders from the harbor master telling him where to drop anchor among the scores of merchant vessels and hundreds of smaller fishing boats already bobbing in the Madras roads. The Americans watched as two crudely fashioned catamarans, teak logs lashed together, each paddled by three kneeling men, struggled out toward them through the waves. Despite the still bright late afternoon sun, the missionaries were clad in black. Their wives wore the long-sleeved dresses with full skirts and many petticoats thought suitable for the wives of clergymen back home. When the first catamaran reached the Saracen and its occupants clambered up the side to deliver anchoring instructions to the captain, the sight of them, dark skins shiny with sweat, naked but for loincloths and standing only a few feet away, drove several of the women and at least two of the men to their cabins to weep with shock and pray for strength. "These are the Hindus. These, the people among whom we came to dwell," the Reverend Ferdinand de Wilton Ward remembered saying to his wife, Jane Shaw Ward, that evening as they settled into their berths to try to get at least a little sleep before going ashore the next morning. Ward had celebrated his 24th birthday at sea. His wife was 7 months older. Everything they had seen that day suggested that the gulf between New England and the ancient land to which they and their companions expected to devote the rest of their lives was wider than they'd imagined, the challenge of conversion greater than they'd dreamed. If the little band of missionaries was to have any impact on India at all, they would have to work together as one, Ward would write, bound up in a united labor of love, with each member careful always to display consistent patience and forbearance. But neither he nor his wife was prepared to remain united with anyone else for long. Neither was patient or forbearing either. In the end, it was not the immovability of India, but the Ward's own intransigence and stubborn self-regard that would first drive the couple home in disgrace and then create the claustrophobic, embittered world that helped warp the personality of their younger son. Reverend Ferdinand de Wilton Ward, the swindler's father and namesake, had been brought up to believe that his family, the Wards of Rochester, New York, were better than other people, more upright, more principled, more godly, and, perhaps as a reward for all that conspicuous virtue, bound to be more successful. Their prosperity and prominence, they believed, were inextricably linked with what Reverend Ward would call their ancestral, heroic, Puritan piety, of which they were never, for an hour, ashamed. They had already prospered in Massachusetts and Connecticut for six generations by 1807, when Ferdinand's grandfather, Deacon Levi Ward, his Yale-educated father, Dr. Levi Ward, Jr., their families and several neighbors, all left Haddam, Connecticut together and joined the stream of New Englanders then headed for the Genesee Woods, the dark, unbroken forest that blanketed most of western New York. From the first, they considered themselves a cut above their fellow pioneers. Deacon Ward saw to it that his wife rode through the forest in a horse-drawn chaise with leather springs, the first such conveyance ever seen in the New York wilderness, or so his descendants later claimed. Once they reached and cleared the site that was first named Wardville and then became part of the village of Bergen, the deacon's eldest son, Dr. Levi Ward, built his family a frame house with cedar shingles rather than a log cabin, even though his new neighbors found it somewhat aristocratic. Ferdinand de Wilton Ward was born in that house on July 9, 1812, the youngest of five boys and the second to youngest child in a family of 13 children, 11 of whom would live to adulthood. His earliest memories included the bright beaded moccasins worn by the Indian hunters who emerged from the woods from time to time with game to barter, and the distant sound of howling wolves, heard as he lay shivering in bed. Author's note: the Wards were as prolific as they were successful. By the time Deacon Ward, the family patriarch, finally passed away at Bergen in 1839 at the age of 92, 22 of his grandchildren and great-grandchildren had died, but three children, 23 grandchildren, and 65 great-grandchildren still survived, a total of 91 living descendants. His father was an unusually successful settler. By the time Ferdinand was born, Dr. Ward was running a provision store, serving his fifth consecutive term as town supervisor, overseeing mail delivery throughout the region, and acting as land agent for the state of Connecticut, charged with selling off some 50,000 acres of cleared forest for farmland and pocketing a handsome commission for every sale. But he was not satisfied. In early 1818, when Ferdinand was 5 and his father was 46, his parents moved their large brood 20 miles or so to the east, to what was then called Rochesterville, on the upper falls of the Genesee River. Only 700 people lived there then, but the tumbling 96-foot cataract at the village's heart was ideally suited for powering mills and workshops, and there was good reason to believe the tiny village would soon outdo all the surrounding settlements. The New York State Legislature had decreed that the 363-mile Erie Canal, connecting Albany on the Hudson to Buffalo on Lake Erie, was to cross the Genesee at Rochester. Work was already underway. Once completed, the canal would link the American heartland for the first time to distant continents and transform the thickly forested Genesee Valley into fields of ripening wheat for sale to the cities of the East. Rochester was about to become the Flower City, the nation's first real boomtown, and Dr. Ward and all his offspring would profit handsomely from its startling growth. Ferdinand grew up in a world in which his father seemed to be everywhere at once, encouraging every new enterprise, urging his neighbors to ever greater effort, summoning up a city from a forest. He helped lobby to make Rochester the seat of the brand new Monroe County, opened stores, bought up big tracts of land, cornered the insurance business, helped establish the Rochester City Bank, the first New York financial institution ever chartered outside New York City, as well as the Rochester Savings Bank, and then served as president and director of each. He was a ruling elder of the First Presbyterian Church, helped establish the Female Charitable Society, the County Poor House, the Western House of Refuge, the Rochester Athenaeum, the Rochester Society for the Promotion of Temperance. He was a life member of the American Colonization and American Tract Societies, too, and president of the Monroe County Bible Society, the very first in the country, whose goal it was to place a Bible in the hands of every citizen willing to accept one. From the largest of the three handsome federal homes he built for himself and his family on North St. Paul Street, he would eventually parcel out his interests among his sons. William, the eldest, known as Colonel because he had briefly commanded the local militia, and Levi A. Ward, the next in line, began adult life as their father's partners in the dry goods business. William never moved very far beyond that status and would die early of cholera, and so Levi became his father's partner in the banking and insurance business, his successor as public benefactor, and, as the years went by, custodian of the family fortune as well. Henry Meigs Ward, just a year younger than Levi and more interested in reading books and writing poetry than money-making, was left to run the Ward farm, several hundred acres north of town, that were eventually laid out in blocks and sold off, lot by lot, to the newcomers flooding into the city. Author's note: Daniel Hand Ward, Deacon Ward's second son, remains a mystery. He was well enough as a boy to carry mail for his father, but in the voluminous Ward family genealogy, only his name and dates, 1796 to 1848, are given. One source suggests he was severely handicapped, another calls him an invalid. In any case, he seems never to have married or to have taken an active part in any of the family's many enterprises. Dr. Ward's daughters also wielded power, mostly through the men they chose to marry. His oldest daughter, Sibba, wed Silas O. Smith, the town's most prominent merchant. Her younger sister, Esther, married one of the town's leading attorneys, Moses Chapin. Susan married another, Samuel L. Selden, who eventually became chief judge of the New York Court of Appeals. Mehitable and Henrietta married two unrelated men with the same last name, Charles Lee Clark and Freeman Clark. The first did well in law. The second did far better as bank president, director of railways and telegraph companies, Whig politician, Republican congressman, and eventually Abraham Lincoln's controller of the currency. Author's note: Elizabeth Ward alone moved away to marry. Her husband, Daniel Hand, was a Connecticut-born businessman who made himself enormously wealthy as a merchant in Atlanta. After the Civil War, he would leave more than $1 million to the American Missionary Society for the education of freedmen. In this highly charged company, young Ferdinand was often overlooked. 14 years younger than the formidable Levi, he was a frail, anxious little boy, severely nearsighted, subject to crushing migraines that often confined him to a darkened room. At 11, he nearly died of rheumatic fever. At 12, he developed St. Vitus's dance, Sydenham's chorea, his face and limbs twitching so uncontrollably that he was sent east to live for a year with an uncle in Guilford, Connecticut, away from the forest and swampland his parents believed were the source of his illnesses. He was lonely, homesick, and chronically fearful. When he returned to Rochester, pale and still convalescent, his mother and father thought it best to have him tutored at home by the family's pastor. That home could be a grim place. For all his formidable energies, Dr. Ward was constitutionally subject to low spirits, his wife said, unaccustomed to opposition, often preoccupied, and always severe. Ferdinand's mother was less forbidding, but conflicted. Perpetually solicitous about his fragile health, she was also given to expressing her regret that, "I had so many children," a lament not calculated to cheer her youngest son. Dr. Ward championed progress and promoted charity, but he also opposed any unnecessary change in the way life was lived in Rochester. A neighbor remembered him as the last man in town to wear the queue, ruffled shirts, and buckled shoes that had been fashionable in New England before he came west. He believed, as did many of the Yankee pioneers who helped create Rochester and most of the other towns in western New York, that the New England world from which they had come should be the model followed by everyone, everywhere. That model included unquestioning observance of the Sabbath. In the Ward homes on North St. Paul Street, everything stopped between Saturday evening and Monday morning. The elder Henry James, who would one day attend college with young Ferdinand, recalled the Sabbaths in his own upstate Presbyterian household. Sunday, he wrote, was the day on which children were taught not to play, not to dance, not to sing, not to read storybooks, not to con over our school lessons for Monday even, not to whistle, not to ride the pony, nor to take a walk in the country, nor a swim in the river, nor, in short, to do anything which nature especially craved. Nothing is so hard for a child as not to do. Dr. Ward was not content just to observe not to do in his own home. He also wanted the Sabbath honored in every household in Rochester. He was instrumental in passing a town ordinance levying a $2 fine on any canal boatman who dared blow his bugle on Sunday. And when his friend and fellow Presbyterian elder Josiah Bissell petitioned Congress to halt the movement of the mails on the Sabbath, Dr. Ward's signature was near the top of the list of the 400 Rochester citizens who signed the document. He also invested in Bissell's Pioneer Line, whose canal boats and stagecoaches pledged not to operate on Sunday. His employees would not swear or drink, Bissell promised, and at least some of our taverns will be without bars. Hot coffee shall always be in waiting and free to the drivers. Both projects failed. Congress rejected the ban on Sunday mail on the grounds that it had no power to legislate with respect to religion. The Pioneer Line collapsed for want of business. Ferdinand's father would now frequently find himself on the losing side of such disputes. The character of Rochester's population was changing fast as newcomers flooded into town, many of them Irish Catholic immigrants, drawn to the region to work on the Erie Canal, who sought new lives but saw no need to change old ways. Still, the old man and his elder sons remained important figures in Rochester, and young Ferdinand shared indirectly in their prominence. When the Marquis de Lafayette visited Rochester in the summer of 1825, Ferdinand's father was co-chairman of the reception committee, and his 13-year-old son was allowed to shake the Revolutionary War hero's hand. A few weeks later, when Governor DeWitt Clinton's flotilla of packet boats arrived at Rochester, en route to New York Harbor and the official opening ceremony of the Erie Canal, young Ferdinand and his father were both invited aboard. The Manhattan parade exceeded anything I ever saw before or expect to see again, Ferdinand remembered, and Governor Clinton himself pinned a commemorative badge on the proud boy's shirt. In the autumn of 1827, Ferdinand was 15 and ready for college. His parents puzzled over what he might do in life. He seemed too frail and highly strung for law or business. Besides, there were older brothers enough to run the family enterprises. Nor did he show any interest in medicine, the field his father had studied at Yale before coming west. But he had always sought his parents' approval by being the most clearly pious among the boys, the quietest on the Sabbath, the most regular in attendance at Sunday school and evening prayers, and there was as yet no clergyman in the family. Perhaps the pulpit would suit him. His father sent him to Hamilton College in Clinton, New York, 2 days away by stagecoach. It was a small Presbyterian institution with a curriculum perfectly suited to a would-be minister, classical, with an emphasis on public speaking. There were 100 students at Hamilton, all boys, and famously unruly. A few years earlier, several of them had hauled a swivel gun up 4 flights to the top of Hamilton Hall and fired it through the door of a fellow student's room, narrowly missing him as he lay sleeping. Subsequent classes celebrated the event on its anniversary each year. At least in retrospect, Ferdinand took no pleasure in that tradition. "A boy who goes to college is ushered into a circle entirely new," he would remember, "where the motto of each individual is, 'Look out for number one,' and where selfishness necessarily predominates. Not enjoying the advantages of social intercourse, he soon becomes as uncivilized and as brutish as those around him." So far as we know, Ferdinand's own brutishness extended only to the stealing and surreptitious roasting of a farmer's chicken, and the memory of that single hilarity, he would write at 70, served as a lifelong reminder of "my state as a sinner." Author's note: his roommate, the son of a pastor from New Hartford, Connecticut, was more adventurous than he, Ferdinand remembered many years later. "Innately wild and a great grief to fond and too indulgent parents. He bought up all the bed cord in town, spent most of the night methodically tying shut every room in every building on the campus, climbed the church steeple, cut the bell rope, and waited for dawn. No church bell rang. There was no chapel, no morning recitation. The culprit was found out and expelled. 'Poor boy,' Ward wrote. 'He ran away from home, went west, and was, I am told, heard of no more. Killed by Indians. His face is now before me, bright, pleasant, but with a will untamed and impulses rudderless.'" He spent only one term at Hamilton. The school's president and trustees were locked in a bitter struggle that drove away most of the student body and very nearly destroyed the institution before transferring to Union College at Schenectady. Its president, the Reverend Eliphalet Knott, was a Presbyterian clergyman liberal-minded enough to have introduced science into the curriculum. His students were well-bred young men from all over the country. "Here," Ferdinand assured his youngest sister Henrietta, "I shall prepare to act a part in life so as not to be unworthy of myself or a dishonor to my parents." That would not always be easy. Ferdinand's class had 89 members. 21 would become clergymen, but most followed more worldly pursuits. Some took up smoking. Some tried alcohol, despite President Knott's earnest warning that those who did so were likely spontaneously to burst into bright blue flame. Ferdinand resisted these temptations, and when his classmates attended balls, he remained in his room. Dancing, his parents had taught him, was frivolous and immoral. But he did join friends in calling upon some of the town's most eligible young women. "I am much pleased with the society of ladies I find here," he told Henrietta. The Albany Microscope, a scandal sheet that specialized in gossip about nearby towns, suggested that Dr. Knott needed to ward off the advances of a certain student on a young Schenectady lady. "It is the town talk," Ferdinand told his sister. "High and low, rich and poor, all are asking, is it true that Mr. Ward is to be married to Miss H?" "It was not," he assured Henrietta. "She is not a Christian. I need say no more." When 18-year-old Ferdinand came home for the holidays in December 1830, the Reverend Charles Grandison Finney had been leading a revival there for nearly 3 months, perhaps the first citywide revival in American history. Josiah Bissell, Ferdinand's father's old ally in the Sabbatarian struggle, had invited Finney to town. there was a large budget of evils rolling through our land and among us, he'd told Finney, the result of rapid changes brought by the Erie Canal. The people and the church say it cannot be helped. And why do they say this? Because they know not the power of the gospel of Jesus. Through Christ Jesus strengthening us, we can do all things, and if so, it is time we were about it. Finney found fertile ground in Rochester. One evening, so many listeners climbed up to the gallery of the Ward's family church, the First Presbyterian, that the stone walls began to spread and plaster sifted down onto the congregation. Panicked men and women pushed through the doors and dove through the windows for fear the building was about to collapse. Other Protestant churches threw open their doors to the temporarily homeless Presbyterians so that Finney could continue his great work. All Rochester was moved that winter, one clergyman remembered. The atmosphere seemed to be affected. You could not go upon the streets and hear any conversations except on religion. On New Year's Eve, at the newly repaired First Church, Finney's co-worker Theodore Weld preached against alcohol with such explosive ardor that 8 grocers, cowering in their pews, vowed never again to sell whiskey to anyone. The next day, surrounded by applauding townspeople, several of them ordered their stock rolled out onto Exchange Street, smashed the barrels, and watched the contents flow into the gutter. To Ferdinand, the would-be clergyman, this was a miracle, vivid proof that Christ was at work in the streets of his hometown. And when Finney himself strode to the pulpit 2 days later, Ferdinand and Henrietta were among his most avid listeners. Henry Stanton, a law student who had watched Finney in action a few weeks earlier, captured the evangelist's impact on even the most normally unexcitable listener. Tall and grave, with blue eyes that seemed almost to glow, Stanton remembered, Finney's way over an audience was wonderful. He went on, while depicting the glories or the terrors of the world to come, he trod the pulpit like a giant. As he would stand with his face towards the side gallery and then involuntarily wheel around, the audience in that part of the house towards which he would throw his arm would dodge as if he were hurling something at them. In describing the sliding of a sinner to perdition, he would lift his long finger towards the ceiling and slowly bring it down till it pointed to the area in front of the pulpit, when half his hearers in the rear of the house would rise unconsciously to their feet to see him descend into the pit below. Author's note, some of Finney's listeners were less admiring. Henry Stanton's future wife, Elizabeth Cady, was taken to hear him as a young girl in the nearby village of York and remembered him as a terrifier of human souls. I was wrought up to such a pitch that I actually jumped and gazed in the direction to which he pointed, while the picture glowed before my eyes and remained with me for months afterwards. Fear of the judgment seized my soul. Visions of the lost haunted my dreams. Mental anguish prostrated my health. Ferdinand and Henrietta were among those who rose unconsciously to their feet that evening and then pledged themselves to Christ, just 2 of the more than 100 men and women who officially joined the church that month alone. If Ferdinand had ever doubted that he should devote himself to the ministry, those doubts now vanished. Henceforth, he wrote his sister after he had returned to college, all his thoughts would be of one class, religion, a subject upon which we should dwell every moment. He issued admonition after admonition over the next few months, excoriating Rochester's backsliders and exhorting his sister to pray morning, noon, and night. In July 1831, 2 weeks before his graduation from Union, he and his roommate walked 7 miles into the countryside so that 18-year-old Ferdinand could preach his first sermon to a schoolhouse filled with farmers and their wives. The text he chose could have been his life's motto, "He that is not for me is against me." Ferdinand planned to spend a year at home before entering Princeton Theological Seminary. The pulpit was now no longer enough for him. He had what he believed to be a higher calling in mind. He was privately determined to become a missionary to the heathen overseas. The missionary ranks he sought to join had begun forming in 1810, when New England Congregationalists established the American Board of Commissioners for Foreign Missions, ABCFM. Presbyterian and Reformed churches lent their united support 2 years later. Author's note: under the 1801 Plan of Union, New England Congregationalists and the General Assembly of the Presbyterian Church had agreed to work together rather than compete as the frontier moved west. The Wards had been Congregationalists back in Connecticut, but had had no difficulty helping to found and enthusiastically support Presbyterian churches once they reached western New York. Historians differ as to precisely what accounted for the extraordinary enthusiasm for foreign missions that gripped New England and upstate New York in the early 19th century, but it is clear that the Puritan denominations, whose old-time supremacy had been undermined at home by new and less austere faiths, found a timely new cause in mission work among Native Americans at home and unbelievers abroad. Meanwhile, the widespread belief that the end was fast approaching, Theodore Weld said it was sure to come before 1850, suggested that there was no time to waste in turning the nations of the world to Christ. To achieve this goal in Europe and Asia, Secretary Rufus Anderson of the American Board foresaw a chain of mission posts extending from Ceylon through the Tamil nation of southern India, the Marathas, the Rajputs, and Afghanistan, Persia, Armenia, and Asia Minor to Constantinople and into European Turkey. Author's note: the Marathi-speaking people of western India had been the earliest overseas targets of the American Board. The first five missionaries to India, three with their wives, had sailed for Bombay in 1812. Almost everything had gone wrong. While they were still at sea, one missionary couple and one of the two bachelors declared themselves Baptists and withdrew from the care of the American Board. Before their ship arrived in India, Britain and the United States went to war, so instead of welcoming them, British authorities threatened deportation. One couple sailed immediately for Mauritius, where the wife died after giving birth to a dead child, and her husband suffered an emotional collapse. Three members of the original party fled to Bombay, where they were placed under house arrest. The married couple, Reverend Samuel Knott and his wife, soon began complaining of economic hardship, ran up heavy debts, demanded the right to make money on the side, and, in 1815, booked passage for home. The American Board privately denounced Knott as a spoilt child, but covered up his activities for fear of driving away funders. The lone survivor, Reverend Gordon Hall, soldiered on in Bombay until his death. In the end, the Board did manage to establish missions in the Middle East, and in the Sandwich Islands, China, and Africa as well. But no serious effort was ever made to link the northern and southern ends of Anderson's chain, and the rest of the field would eventually be left to other denominations, Baptists, Lutherans, Methodists, even Unitarians and Friends, all eventually staked claims to different parts of the Indian subcontinent, the minute doctrinal differences between them providing an endless source of puzzlement to those they hoped to convert. The cause of Christ consumed pious young people of Ferdinand's generation. Two members of his own family would go abroad as missionaries: his distant cousin Alonzo Chapin, who sailed for the Sandwich Islands in November 1831, and his niece Maria Ward Chapin Smith, who would accompany her husband, Reverend Eli Smith, to Syria sometime later. Ferdinand was eager to join them. "No one was dependent upon me for a livelihood," he recalled. "I had a good constitution. I had a full, if not an exceptional, aptitude to acquire a foreign language. Above all," he wrote, "he was called loudly to go abroad." But when he told his parents what he had in mind, they were horrified. His mother could not bear to have her youngest boy vanish overseas. His father was adamant against his going. Ferdinand's constitution was far too fragile for the foreign field. He was extremely nearsighted, anxious, still subject to migraines, and too easily agitated when things did not go his way. His father told him he could do just as much good close to home as he could abroad, and that he was far too young to make so momentous a decision. And so, Ferdinand went off to Princeton in June 1832, knowing that his father and mother were displeased with his plans. It required a struggle of no ordinary intensity to leave home this time, he told his sister, and an agony of struggle at the throne of grace to make my will bow to the decision of my conscience, a joy mingled with tears. At 19, he was the youngest member of his seminary class of 94, severely homesick and initially disheartened by the seminary's Spartan ways. Breakfast and supper same, i.e. bread, molasses, cup of water. No pie. But he was also gratified that the subject of missions is on every side and in every forum, and especially pleased when one of his teachers told the class, "We should not object to your all going abroad. Let the home churches look after themselves. It will do them good." Author's note: in the end, 7 members of his class would enter the mission field. A cloud of fear hung over the entire eastern United States that spring, the likelihood that the cholera pandemic ravaging the old world was about to descend upon the new. It had begun in Bengal in 1817, reached China by 1820, Moscow in 1830, Western Europe the following year. It killed at an appalling rate. 55,000 died in Great Britain, more than twice that number in France. Patients who seemed fine at breakfast were often dead by dinner. Sudden, agonizing cramps led to simultaneous violent diarrhea and vomiting that so dehydrated victims they literally shrank, turned blue, and often became unrecognizable even to family members sitting helpless at their bedsides. No one understood what caused it. Common treatments like camphor, laudanum, charcoal, bleeding, and a mercury compound called calomel either had no effect or made things worse. Americans prayed that the Atlantic might prove a barrier against it, but the first cases of cholera appeared in New York in early June 1832. Soon, 100 people were dying in Manhattan every day, and the disease was racing inland along the canals and aboard the steamboats of which Americans were so proud. It reached Rochester on July 12th. The first victim lived on South St. Paul Street, only a few blocks from the wards. A second man fell ill 2 days later. Soon there were dozens of fresh cases every day, so many that straw pallets had to be laid out for them beneath a crude open-air shelter on the western bank of the Erie Canal. Ferdinand's father was asked to chair a public meeting at the courthouse to see what else might be done. He was a physician as well as a leading citizen, but all he could do was call upon the family pastor to offer up a prayer. Everywhere, including Rochester, clergymen declared the outbreak divine punishment, called down upon God's chosen country for its ingratitude. "Obscene impurities, drunkenness, profanities, and infidelity prevail among us to a fearful extent," said a pamphlet rushed into print by the American Tract Society. "Iniquity runs down our streets like a river." 400 people would fall ill in Rochester before the pandemic burned itself out. 116 died. More than 1,000 residents fled into the countryside and found temporary homes in taverns and farmhouses as far as 30 miles away. All of this Ferdinand was forced to learn from the newspapers. For 3 weeks, no one in his preoccupied family found the time to write to him. And as their silence continued, Ferdinand grew more and more fearful, convinced that the worst had happened. At the best of times, his health was merely tolerable, he told Henrietta in a frenzied 6-page letter begging for news. But now, haunted by dark thoughts of what might be occurring at home, he could not sleep, waking again and again, sometimes screaming, sometimes weeping. He suffered turns of fainting, too, which lasted as long as 3 minutes, so that I often dread to rise from my seat lest I should fall. Even when he tried to pray, excited feelings deprived him of the use of reason. In the end, cholera spared the Ward household, but Ferdinand's parents had to dispatch Henrietta to Princeton to nurse their distraught son back to health. Ferdinand's extreme anxiety and the alarming symptoms it engendered in him further persuaded his father that he could not possibly endure the rigors of mission life. Ferdinand's psychological state worried his professors, too, but they were themselves so caught up in the enthusiasm for missions that they continued to offer him only encouragement. 2 of them wrote a joint letter assuring the ABC-FM that in the end Ferdinand's singular prudence and propriety and his deep and ardent piety would more than make up for his delicate health. Ferdinand agreed. He was now in a hurry. The full Princeton curriculum required 3 years to master. As soon as the Presbytery of Rochester licensed him to preach, in the autumn of 1833, he left the seminary rather than wait to graduate. He then had three choices, he recalled: undertaking an overseas mission, joining a mission among emigrants and Indians in the American West, or taking up a tranquil pastorate among the cultured and reformed. His family and friends all favored the latter, and were already selecting just the place for him. His brother-in-law Freeman Clark helped arrange for him to occupy a pulpit in Albion, New York, during the summer of 1834 to see how he liked preaching in a small town. He didn't. The following winter, his father saw to it that he stayed with his sister and brother-in-law in Augusta, Georgia, so that he could venture out to mission stations among the Choctaw and Chickasaw, in the hopes that a season of preaching to them might prove satisfyingly exotic. It did not. Nor did he enjoy several weeks standing in for the pastor of Rochester's Second Presbyterian Church, or a summer-long stand at Philadelphia's fashionable 10th Street Church, though the latter did allow him to study rudimentary medicine at the Jefferson Medical School, which he hoped would help him to better withstand missionary life. Ferdinand refused to alter his plans. "My eye is fixed upon a distant point," he told his sister. His mother, finally, reluctantly, agreed to let him go, but his father continued to withhold his blessing. "The thought of taking a step which shall contradict his feelings is to me most painful," Ferdinand told Secretary Anderson of the ABC-FM. "No son was ever possessed of a kinder parent. I am the youngest son, and the only one that has taken upon himself any public duties. My life is fast passing. 22 years have already gone, and I must soon be in the field." In June 1836, Ferdinand's application was formally approved, with one proviso. Before he embarked for South India that November, he must find himself a wife and marry her at least 2 months before they set sail. It was unwise, the American board believed, to dispatch even the most God-fearing young men to exotic lands unaccompanied. The temptations of the flesh were too strong for safety. Marriage was the natural state of man in any case, Secretary Anderson had written. A missionary needed a wife as much as a minister did, as friend, counselor, companion, the repository of her husband's thoughts and feelings, the partaker of his joys, the sharer of his cares and sorrows, and one who is to lighten his toils and become his nurse in sickness. "The board say I must marry," Ferdinand complained to a classmate, "and give to that object my entire time. I do not like it. I want time. You will hear if anything is affected." Author's note: 3 years earlier, he had written his sister Henrietta to keep an eye out for a future wife for him. "She must be a Christian, intelligent, and not homely." Something was affected, and with remarkable speed. In April of the previous year, while preaching in Philadelphia, he had met a young woman named Jane Shaw at the home of a mutual friend. He had liked her better than any other young lady I had ever seen, he remembered, but he hadn't managed to see her again. Now, with the board insisting he marry, something, I do not remember what, led me to imagine that Miss Shaw might view with favor an invitation to be my home companion to India. I went to the city and called upon her. He was evidently slow to come to the point. "We had many pleasant conversations upon many general subjects, and, of course, on missions. At one time she expressed the opinion that missionaries ought to go out single. That was enough for me. As I did not desire to receive a negative, I said no more upon the subject, but returned home to Philadelphia." Then he got a note from a friend in New York. He had given up too quickly, it said. He should go back and try again. He boarded a steamboat for the city, and as it stopped at Matawan Landing, near Fishkill, Jane Shaw herself happened to come aboard. He nervously asked if he could call. She said he could. Since her father's death, she had been living at the downtown New York home of her sister and brother-in-law, Mr. and Mrs. Christopher Robert. she would be glad to receive him there. Author's note: Christopher Robert, married to Jane's youngest sister, Anna Maria Shaw, was a successful importer of sugar, cotton, and tea, and would become president of the Delaware, Lackawanna, and Western Railroad after the Civil War. He shared fully in his sister-in-law's Presbyterian zeal and would eventually use his wealth to fund a number of religious institutions at home and to provide the initial funds with which Robert College was established just outside Constantinople. Before he made his call, he lunched at a Manhattan restaurant with a friend of hers, Reverend Charles Hall, assistant secretary of the Home Missionary Society. They took a corner table, Ferdinand recalled, and he nervously asked Hall whether he thought Miss Shaw might make a suitable wife for a foreign missionary. "Excellent," Hall answered. "But," he continued, "she is an heiress, and may want to go alone, independent of man or board. You can try, and she can but say no." Ferdinand screwed up his courage, called upon Miss Shaw at her brother-in-law's home, and, although he had spoken with her just 3 times, proposed marriage, and, ere long, received a yes, much to my joy. Jane Shaw was 24 years old that June, small, wiry, and deaf in one ear. She would always consider herself unattractive. She was slight and stooped even as a child, with a prominent nose and hands and feet larger than she liked. "Altogether, I am so ugly," she would write to her daughter toward the end of her long life. "How often I wonder why I have to be subject to so much mortification as regards my hands and feet. When I am dead, please don't let my hands be laid across my breast, but close to my sides." Her girlhood in downtown Manhattan had been comfortable but emotionally parched. Her father, William Shaw, was a successful but preoccupied Irish-born shipping merchant whose fleet sailed between Belfast and New York. Her mother, Elizabeth Johnson, was a frail New Yorker with an inheritance of her own. Jane, the third of 6 children, lost herself in books, loved studies, developed a reputation for Christian ardor that was at least a match for that of her new fiancé, and dreamed of somehow becoming a missionary. Asked one Sunday morning while still a little girl to contribute something valuable to her church, she had placed in the collection plate a slip of paper on which she had written, "Myself." Then, when she was 15, her mother suddenly died. Jane was taken out of school to serve as her father's housekeeper and hostess and to act as surrogate mother to her younger sister and 2 younger brothers. She was too young for the task and very nearly overwhelmed. The church became still more important to her, a refuge as well as a house of worship. When Reverend Hall was asked to assess her potential as a missionary's wife, he responded with enthusiasm. Her interest in religious work was not a spasm of romantic feeling, but such as may be calculated to inspire her as long as she lives. The temptations of refined and worldly society have not hindered her from being a devoted missionary among the poor, the ignorant, and repulsive population on the outskirts of our city. Her own pastor, Reverend Asa D. Smith of the 14th Street Presbyterian Church, was equally positive. Miss Shaw was uniformly good, uncommonly so, he wrote, and filled with an unusually large measure of the missionary spirit. God has been anointing her for the work to which she is now looking. Ferdinand was formally to be ordained as a missionary on August 31st. He appointed the 29th as a day of fasting and renewal for himself and his bride-to-be. That evening, she wrote him a letter setting forth her reasons for agreeing to marry him on such short acquaintance. It had little to do with him and everything to do with what she believed to be the cause of Christ. Marriage to Ferdinand would make it possible for her to answer the call they both had heard. It was not until the spring of the previous year that she had first felt a personal duty in relation to the heathen, she explained. Appeals for help from men and women already in the field, including John J. Lawrence, an old friend who had sailed for South India in May, had moved her to explore the possibility of going abroad on her own. "She had comparatively few ties that bound me to my native land," she wrote, "and was blessed with a small inheritance to cover her expenses, and so, after praying with great earnestness to be led to do what would best glorify God, I decided that I would go, if God should see fit to send me. He had not seen fit to send her, at least not at first. She made arrangements to accompany a British Baptist couple to a mission in Orissa, on India's eastern coast, only to have them rescind the invitation when they were assigned elsewhere. She consulted Reverend Myron Winslow, who was home on a brief visit after spending more than a quarter of a century in the American Board's first mission to the Tamils at Jaffna, Ceylon, to see whether she might be welcome there. She was not. He told her firmly that there was no room for single women in the mission field. Another missionary couple asked her to accompany them to Java, but the arguments of judicious friends against my going out single led me to hold back and decide on remaining at home. She had been bitterly disappointed at her own timidity, she wrote, and my weak, sinful heart began to grow cold and selfish. Author's note. Her friends were Reverend and Mrs. Elbert Nevius. Because Mrs. Nevius was in frail health, her husband wanted another woman along to help care for her and to teach school in her spare time. When Jane Shaw backed off, his wife's sister, Mrs. Uba C. Condit, agreed to go as an assistant missionary and became perhaps the first single American woman ever to engage in mission work. Mrs. Nevius's health did not improve and eventually forced her and her husband to abandon the mission field and return home in 1843. His sister-in-law remained overseas, however, became the third wife of Reverend David O. Allen of the Bombay Mission, and died just 6 months later. Then, she told Ferdinand, he had entered her life. She saw it as a sign from God. My heavenly Father at length opened a way for me to the very field on which my heart was first fixed, and the call seemed so decidedly one of his own making, and his providence in it so marked and peculiar, that I was led to consider and pray over it until my feelings were so enlisted and my views of duty so clear that the present determination to go in company with one of his dear servants was made, and with humble gratitude I now hold myself in readiness to do, to be, and to suffer whatever he may will concerning me. Do you think that the above narration contains anything that should cause you to believe I have been called to go with you? If so, I am yours, for now you know all, and I feel happy to think that my heart has really unburdened itself to you. I prayed that God would direct me what to say, and I know and feel that he has. This has been in many respects a pleasant day to me, and I have been enabled to pray with much earnestness for my beloved Ferdinand. My heart feels lighter under the firm conviction that if it should after all be best for me not to go, God will prevent me. Oh, it is pleasant to feel that we are his, and he will use us for himself. Still continue to pray for me, my dear friend. The time draws near when we are to take solemn vows upon us, and I will need much, very much grace to qualify me for a situation so responsible, conspicuous, and solemn. May God prepare you to bear the responsibilities and trials which a union with me may impose upon you. Sometimes I fear that you will not be happy with me. My disposition is yet unknown to you. The weaknesses of my character have not yet been developed, and you know but little of her whom you so tenderly love. Oh, that you may not be forced to discover anything that will forfeit that affection. Farewell, my much-loved friend. May your heart and your trust be in heaven. With fond affection, I am yours, Jane. 2 days after she finished her letter to Ferdinand, on August 31, 1836, he and another newly minted minister, Reverend Henry Cherry, were ordained as missionaries to South India in the First Presbyterian Church at Rochester. The enterprise upon which they were about to embark, said the presiding pastor, promised the certainty of success. The Spirit of God is with his servants. Light is dawning in every quarter of the world. As the two young missionaries left the church surrounded by tearful well-wishers, a hymn especially composed and performed for the occasion echoed in their ears. Trusting in Christ, go, heralds, rear the gospel standard, void of fear. Go, seek with joy your destined home, and preach a Savior there unknown. Yes, Christian heroes, go, proclaim, salvation in Emmanuel's name, to distant climes the tidings bear, and plant the rose of Sharon there. The congregation's tears were understandable. It was presumed that missionaries would live out their lives abroad. Withdrawal from the field, one early missionary wrote, was an admission of failure, a lasting stigma. India was at least 4 months away, unimaginably strange, haunted by mysterious fevers. Of the 91 missionaries, assistant missionaries, and their wives whom the American board had sent to Ceylon and India since 1815, 21 had already died, as had many of their children. Both Ferdinand and Jane arranged to sit for portraits, so that if they did not return, their friends and families might remember what they had looked like. They were married on September 16th in New York City. Jane's brother-in-law, Christopher Robert, appeared as a witness for the couple and loaned them $300 with which to start their lives together, just under $7,000 in purchasing power today. But no member of the Ward family attended, and no part of the Ward fortune was given to them as a wedding gift. Ferdinand's father was still unable to bear the thought of his youngest son defying him and disappearing overseas. In a letter to Rochester written 2 days after the wedding, Ferdinand hoped his father would one day learn to love my dear Jane, now my wife, and be willing to address her as daughter. The American board booked passage to India aboard the merchant ship Saracen for the Wards and six other couples, all of whom had also recently married in order to qualify for the mission field. Like Ferdinand, William Tracy had attended Princeton Seminary. Clarendon Muzzy had graduated from Andover. Henry Cherry, Edward Cope, and Nathaniel Crane had all attended Auburn, where their fellow passenger Dr. John Steele, who was to act as their physician, had studied medicine. All of them and their wives came from New England or from New England families who had settled in New York and Pennsylvania. All were imbued with the Puritan faith of their forebears, and all expected to reinforce the same new mission among the Tamils at the ancient temple town of Madura, modern Madurai, some 275 miles southeast of Madras. The evening before they were to board their ship at Boston, a mass farewell meeting was held at the Bowden Street Church. Ferdinand, Jane, and the rest of their missionary band were ushered to the front pew. The Gothic interior was kept dim until everyone was seated. Then, a missionary newspaper reported, precisely at the hour, an additional quantity of gas was suddenly let into the lamps, which instantaneously filled the house with a glare of light. At the same moment, the organ burst forth into peals which shook the whole edifice, as though the whole congregation were putting forth their acclamation of joy. Several clergymen addressed those about to embark, holding them up as exemplars for all Christians everywhere. "The Lord Jesus has sent you," Reverend Hubbard Winslow told the missionary band. "He is the head, and the apostles are your predecessors." Like the apostles, these new missionaries might not be absolutely perfect, he continued, but they were eminently holy. Ferdinand had written to his parents that evening, begging them to write to him often in India. "I love you, notwithstanding the apparent contradiction of my conduct. Will you pray for me? I have taken a serious step. I need grace, constant grace. We may not meet again on earth. God grant we may above." The next day, November 23, 1836, just moments before the Saracen slipped out of Boston Harbor into the open sea, he scribbled another note. "Dear Father, pilot soon leaves. I only say I am leaving native land, home, friends, to do good. My motive is, as far as I think, pure. God bless you all. Love to Mother, dear Mother. Your son, Ferdinand." His mother would write to him from time to time in India over the next few years. His unforgiving father never did. Ferdinand remembered the four-month voyage to India as a test of my Christian character. Each couple aboard the Saracen was assigned one of seven cabins in the first hold. Ferdinand bravely pronounced them commodious. In fact, each was only 6 feet wide, with room for no furnishings other than a chair, a table, and two berths, the lowest hung high enough so that trunks and boxes could be slid beneath it. The weather turned bad within a day or two of setting sail, and the Wards and all their fellow missionaries became violently seasick. Loose luggage slammed against the cabin walls. Portholes had to be shut and secured against the waves, cutting off the air. Vomit and seawater sloshed from one side of the heaving cabin floor to the other. The stench was almost unbearable. It took several days before most of the husbands could bring themselves to leave their cabins, and several days more before the wives felt well enough to venture out on deck. One man did not regain his feet for nearly 8 weeks, and according to Ferdinand, none of the women felt fully restored until the voyage ended. On the whole, the owners of merchant vessels welcomed missionaries. They could be counted on to book passage in groups, for one thing, and they helped fill empty cargo space on outward-bound voyages to distant destinations that did not interest other travelers. Captains forced to spend months with them at sea were generally less enthusiastic. The Massachusetts mariner Nathaniel Ames, for one, thought missionaries obnoxious cargo, and saw no need ever to choose sides in the ongoing battle between Calvin and Vishnu. Captain Joseph P. Thompson, commander of the Saracen, quickly came to share that view. Before the missionaries set sail, Ferdinand recalled, Thompson assured them that during the 4-month voyage, we should have as much preaching and praying as we chose. That turned out to be a great deal. There was a full-scale church service each Sunday morning at which Ferdinand and the other missionaries took turns delivering sermons from the forecastle. But every other morning of the week, the Wards and the other missionaries also held prayer services before breakfast and studied scripture afterward. There was a daily 11 o'clock prayer meeting on deck, then Bible classes after lunch, a ladies' prayer meeting at tea time, and a second on-deck prayer meeting after dinner. Hymns were sung with voices raised in order to be heard over the constant barnyard clamor that emanated from the chickens, ducks, and geese kept in crates on deck, a clamor that rose to a terrified crescendo at the slightest sign of rain. At first, Captain Thompson found his passengers at least tolerable. He and his wife even attended the Sabbath services on deck for a week or two. But as time went by, he began to find the missionaries' unremitting piety grating. They insisted on calling one another brother and sister and seemed always to be trying to impress everyone, including themselves, with the gravity of their endeavor. Sprightliness, in private, might be justified in some circumstances, Ferdinand told his parents in a letter written aboard the Saracen, but levity is never admissible in an intelligent, immortal, accountable being. And the missionaries soon made it clear to Thompson that they saw it as their duty not only to pray among themselves, but also to bring to Christ the Saracen's entire crew, 13 hard-drinking, hard-living, tough-talking seamen. To that end, they began to interrupt the sailors' work at all hours of the day, handing them tracts, offering counsel, and exhorting them to repent. As Ferdinand reported to the board back in Boston, Thompson finally could stand it no longer. As we advanced about our course of converting the crew, his manners changed, and the strong enmity of his natural heart began to manifest itself. He used profane language in our presence, and as it was continued, we unitedly remonstrated through a committee. But to that remonstrance he gave no heed, continuing a practice which by his own acknowledgment was useless and to us painful on the plea that when he was excited he did not know what he was doing. He kept an uncalled-for watch over us while conversing with the seamen, often calling them to engage in some employment which was unnecessary, and on one occasion, for a cause quite insufficient, prohibited all conversation with the men at any time. The missionaries declared a day of fasting and prayer to persuade the captain to change his mind. He did eventually, but life aboard the ship had been tense from then on, especially during 2 weeks when the Saracen was becalmed off Ceylon, the sun merciless, the cabins airless and hot, the sea like a polished silver plate stretching away in all directions. When the ship finally dropped anchor off Madras, passengers and captain were equally glad that the voyage had come to an end. 2. Laboring in Hope. The Wards spent their first night in Madras in a spacious whitewashed bungalow on the seashore at Royapuram, just north of Fort St. George. It was the new home and headquarters of the Reverend Myron Winslow, the veteran missionary from Jaffna, who had earlier told Jane she would not be welcome if she came to Ceylon alone. He had so recently arrived at Madras to set up this new station, intended primarily to provide printed materials in Tamil, that no one aboard the Saracen had known it existed before coming ashore. Now, Reverend Winslow had another surprise for the Saracen passengers, all of whom had assumed they were to proceed immediately to Madura. Most of the Saracen company would leave by oxcart in mid-April as planned, he said, but the board had authorized him to retain two of the newcomers to strengthen the new mission run by him and another Jaffna veteran, Dr. John Scudder. He asked the brethren of the Saracen company themselves to decide who among them was to stay behind. At an evening meeting held at the home of Dr. Scudder, they chose Ferdinand and Jane, and William Tracy and his wife Emily. There is no way of knowing now why the rest of the Saracen company voted as they did. It may have been as simple as the fact that Ferdinand and Tracy were both Princeton men, while Cherry, Cope, Crane, and Steele had all attended Auburn together and had not wished to be separated. But Ferdinand was not pleased. He felt rejected, set apart, discriminated against. According to his skeletal journal, it took him 3 days to conclude that it is my duty to remain at Madras, and he finally gave in only because it had been the unanimous opinion of the brethren that he do so. He would never again so easily defer to his colleagues. The Wards struggled to adjust to India. Went among the natives with Mr. Winslow, Ferdinand noted early on. Oh, the wretchedness and moral death! April, May, and early June marked the height of summer, with temperatures hovering around 100 degrees, tempers frayed. Helped wife move boxes and unpack bedding, Ferdinand noted after they moved into a rented bungalow of their own at Rayapuram. Got some cross words and quick words. Felt bad all the evening. The sights and sounds of the city streets defeated Ferdinand's powers of description. They made him feel, he wrote, just as he had after his first visit to New York City, when he looked with wonder upon the strange things of Broadway. Some 400,000 people lived in and around Madras, twice the population of New York. Ferdinand commissioned an artist to paint a series of street scenes to be sent home to Rochester, the seaside bungalow in which he and Jane were living, a street barber at work in the open air, a goldsmith tapping at his miniature forge, an entertainer leading a costumed monkey on a string, a Shaivite mendicant smeared with ash and strung with prayer beads, and another Hindu devotee in the throes of religious fervor, slashing at his own thigh as a symbol of his zeal, a sight, Ferdinand lamented, seen frequently in the streets. He grew frustrated by the unexpected difficulty of learning Tamil. It is a fearfully ugly language, wrote one English newcomer, clattering, twittering, chirping, sputtering, like a whole poultry yard let loose upon one, and not a single singing bird, not a melodious sound among them. And he found the languid pace of life insufferable. Patience, he wrote, requires an amount of Christian feeling which I cannot command to keep peace with the slow method of doing things in this land. That the natives should demonstrate this spirit is not strange, but it pervades the whole country. They talk of a week as we do of a day. It all became too much for him. Day after day, and sometimes for as long as 2 weeks without a break, he recorded his suffering from sick headache, excitement, exhaustion and fatigue, and repeated attacks of dysentery, which he decorously called an ailment common in this climate, and for which 15 leeches were once applied by a British physician, to little effect except to further weaken the already depleted patient. Jane was often ill as well. The Wards' frequent illness did not prevent them from taking tea with British clergymen or keep Ferdinand from preaching several times to the British congregation of the Davidson Street Church in Blacktown. And when the news reached Madras in August that William IV of England had died 2 months earlier, Ferdinand was able to drag himself from his sickbed long enough to accompany Jane to the fort to witness the troops arrayed and hear the proclamation that Princess Victoria is queen. Then, after 5 months in Madras, the Reverends Ward and Tracy and their wives were suddenly told they were to proceed to Madura after all. There was no longer enough money in the treasury of the Madras mission to pay them. On September 19th, they set out for Madura, the Hindu bastion that was now to be their home. The journey took 20 days. Ferdinand rode in an ox cart, careful to hew to the economic strictures insisted upon by the American board. But he saw to it that Jane was carried in a palanquin borne on the shoulders of teams of 6 men. They chanted in Tamil as they hurried on. "She's not heavy, putaram, putaram. Carry her softly, putaram, putaram. Nice little lady, putaram, putaram. Carry her gently." A cook and a bearer named Gabriel came along too, with 2 coolies to carry utensils. Nights were spent in government rest houses, spaced a day's travel apart, and each cared for by a watchman who could be relied upon to strangle a chicken for the evening meal. The countryside through which they passed was lush and green after the monsoon, thick forests interspersed with rice fields and groves of coconut palms. Distant blue hills, reminiscent, Ferdinand told the American board, of upstate New York. Our fatherland. They crossed the rivers that twisted across their path in circular buffalo skin boats 30 feet across. There were troops of monkeys, too, and a huge banyan tree alive with fruit bats. At night, the weird, far-off wailing of jackals reminded Ferdinand of the sound of the wolves that had haunted his boyhood sleep. It all might have seemed like a rare adventure if the Ward's religious convictions had permitted them to enjoy any of it wholeheartedly. But signs of the faith they had sworn to eradicate were everywhere. "If we are delighted with the appearance of a fresh and shady grove," Ferdinand wrote, "our spirits sink at the sight of the images its branches hide." Even the friendly villagers who came out to watch them pass, "the poor, degraded, yet immortal beings around me," Ferdinand called them, inspired in him only a sense of helplessness. He was still too inarticulate in Tamil to keep them from the fiery doom from which he was sure his gospel message would otherwise have saved them. On October 9, 1837, the Wards and the Tracys at last came within sight of the 2 giant gopurams of the Sri Meenakshi Temple at Madura. Some 40,000 people lived in the temple's shadow, most of them devotees of Shiva and his local consort, Meenakshi. As the little party moved toward the city walls, they fell in with a stream of pilgrims, whose joyful shouting of the names of their deities struck Ferdinand and Jane as demonic. The Reverend William Todd greeted them within the dusty mission compound. He was just 36, but seemed far older. Todd had established the American outpost 3 years earlier with the help of just 2 other missionaries from Jaffna and 3 Tamil-speaking Ceylonese. It had not been easy. Madura was inexpressibly filthy, Todd had reported to the American board not long after he got there, a tangle of narrow, squalid streets filled with refuse, permeated by the stench of sewage and stagnant water, ravaged annually by cholera. The city had once been the capital of the Pandyan kings, in whose tumble-down former palace a mob had once threatened to kill Todd if he did not stop maligning their gods. But it was now almost exclusively a place of Hindu pilgrimage, a stronghold of religious debauchery, Todd told the board. Tumultuous processions, wild and fantastic as the dreams of a maniac, pervade the city night and day, making the idolaters drunk with the excess of glare, noise, and folly, all in barbarous taste. Todd's first wife had died within weeks of her arrival. He had then married a widow, who had herself already buried 2 missionary husbands, only to watch her die too. His Ceylonese helpers languished from homesickness. His own physical and psychological health had dangerously deteriorated. Author's note. Todd's depression would steadily deepen. He eventually asked to be allowed to resign his post, but then to stay on at Madura and try to find some other work. His fellow missionaries insisted he go home. They argued to the American board that having one of their number jobless and single, no longer preaching God's word, and evidencing what they called a diseased mind, would constitute a blot on the mission. Boston eventually agreed. Todd sailed home. He was bitter for a time. He refused the allowance for himself and the children of his second wife to which he was entitled, but his devotion to the mission cause never wavered. In 1858, he went west to Clay County, Kansas, where he preached until his death in 1874 in a one-room schoolhouse he named the Madura Congregational Church. Still, despite everything, without ever mastering Tamil and with only sporadic reinforcements from Jaffna and the United States, Todd had organized a small congregation, started 35 free primary schools for boys and one for girls, established a secondary school in which students were taught in English, and dispatched missionaries to establish a second mission 38 miles to the northwest in Dindigul. Todd had asked Boston for 27 additional missionaries to carry on and expand his work. He got just 7. The most recent newcomers would not prove as helpful as Todd had hoped. Shortly after the Wards moved into a single room on the roof of the bungalow newly assigned to Reverend and Mrs. Crane, Ferdinand met with Todd and the rest of the missionary brethren and was told he and Jane would immediately have to shift again to the new outpost at Dindigul. Ferdinand was again displeased at being told what to do and where to go. This time, after at least one visit to the British assistant surgeon responsible for seeing to the health of Europeans in the district, and several days of prayer and agitating the question, he announced that he and Jane would not move. Perhaps it was fears about his health that made him do it. Dr. Steele, the mission physician, who had been stationed at Dindigul, was about to leave for Jaffna for his own health. He was suffering from a lung ailment that would eventually be diagnosed as tuberculosis.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.